Thank you and good morning to everyone, and thank you for zooming into this meeting of the Corporate and Partnerships Overview and Scrutiny Committee on Monday the 14th of September 2020 at 10:30. First thing on the agenda is minutes of the meeting held on the 2nd of March, pages 5 to 12. They have been circulated. Can we receive and accept those minutes as a true record? If someone can, please. Moved by Mike Jordan, seconded by
Bryn.
Thank you, Bryn. Has anyone any matters that wish to bring up from the minutes? If not, quickly along to agenda item two, apologies and declarations of interest. First of all, has anyone any declarations of interest on any items that appear on the agenda today? No one appeared in the chat box. As any apologies, Ray, can I come to you?
No apologies received, Chairman.
Thank you, Ray. Whilst you're on, Ray, public questions or statements, have we received any?
None received.
Thank you, Ray. We'll move on to, and I presume, along with committee members, Ray, we do have councillors Chance and the leader on board. Is that correct?
That's correct, Chairman.
I'd like to welcome both Councillor Chance and Councillor Les to the meeting along with our members. We'll move on to agenda item four, which is the equality and diversity. And is Deborah Hugill, are there, Deborah?
I am here, Chair, yes.
Nice to hear from you, dear.
My video, there I am. Right.
Oh, there you are, yeah.
Yes. Good Deborah, morning, everybody.
Thank you. If you'd like, it's over to you then, Deborah, please.
Thank you very much. Yes, this report is the annual overview of progress with achieving the Council's equality and diversity objectives, and also provides an update on the work of the Management Board Task Group in relation to equality and diversity. So our public sector equality duty requires us to prepare and publish one or more equality objectives at least every 4 years. And our last set of objectives were agreed in September 2016. So progress towards those objectives is listed in the appendix. But clearly that was 4 years ago, and the objectives are due to be refreshed in 2020, and work had begun on this before the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic. Since then, available staff time to look at those objectives has been extremely limited due to one thing and another. And actually, the impact of the pandemic's actually meant that we need to have a re-evaluation of those priorities anyway. So even if we had done all that work, I think we'd still be looking back at them now because of the inequalities that have been exposed by that pandemic around all sorts of things, around the fact that schools were closed, people were made unemployed, economic hardship, health disparities. There's a whole range of things that have kind of added to issues that we've got in the county. So we're starting on work to reflect that and refine those equality priorities. And I can give you more information on that if you're interested later. But also the second half of the report talks about work by Management Board Task Group, which aims to foster a more positive and inclusive approach to equality and diversity within the council. Now, the work of that group was also set back by the COVID pandemic and various other things that have come along since. But I've given you a little update there on where we are in terms of progress. In June, a report was taken to Management Board because it was identified that specific inequalities were being exposed by the pandemic and also had been highlighted by the Black Lives Matter campaign. And Management Board had a discussion about that, about how the County Council should respond. And a couple of things that are worth noting there is that a third of our workforce haven't provided information on their ethnicity, so we need to improve that, and we're working on how that can be done. And also the lack of staff networks for people with protected characteristics was also noted, and needing really some capacity there to support any networks in order for them to be effective. Now, we have got a newly appointed graduate in HR who's got a specific focus on equality and diversity, which we're hoping will help a lot. She only started last week, so her work programme is being developed. Also, following the discussion at Management Board, an NYCC Black, Asian and Minority Ethnic Network has been set up to be chaired by the Assistant Chief Executive, and that is due to start meeting. I think its first meeting is at the end of this month, so that's moving on. There's also an agreement that we will put together a wider equality reference group as well to encourage these conversations on equality issues. And as part of that, in many respects, there's been quite a few, you will have noticed, quite a few more intranet blogs highlighting and celebrating diversity, which have been extremely well received by staff. So I think all of those things add up to a more open culture, which is something we really need to work on, because that will help people feel more comfortable, I think, about declaring their ethnicity and having more open conversations about quality issues. So those are the things I particularly wanted to highlight, but obviously I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Deborah. Can I invite Councillor Griffiths? You've indicated you wish to speak. Bryn?
Thank you, Chair. Hello, Deborah. Thanks for that update. One thing that I found a bit difficult to understand was the summary of the objectives, where we have objectives but there's no timescales for progressing those or achieving them. And I see that you're going to, I'm disappointed with that, I see that you're going to refresh these objectives shortly. Can I ask that you consider putting in some timescales so we can focus and give some degree of priority to getting these objectives completed?
Absolutely, I entirely agree, and that has been highlighted as an issue. And one of the things that we want to do is make sure that those equality objectives tie in much more to the performance framework. So they will have smart targets, they will have specific actions, they will have key performance indicators. So yeah, that's something that we are putting into the new objectives. So thank you.
I'm pleased to hear that. Thank you.
Thank you, Deborah. Members, I should have warned you or advised you that I intend to sort of canter through the appendix just to give members every opportunity to ask questions on any items in the appendix. If no one else has at the moment any questions, I have a couple, and you have touched on them, Deborah, and that was on 4.3. It was regarding a third of the workforce. And I just wondered if there was a reasoning behind that, and if there was, have we addressed that reasoning?
I think it's a long-standing issue that we have had, and I think it probably is related to a culture where it's not adverse to these sorts of things, and I think people are open to it, but there's not a lot discussed at a higher level. And I think that is improving now, that is changing. And I do think that a more open discussion about diversity and equality, if it's in people's blogs or whether it's in conversations in the office, all those sorts of things help people feel that they can be open a bit more. And I think the Black and Asian Minority Ethnic Network will help that, because people will see other people coming forward to discuss those things in a way that is you know, open and people are able to join in. So I think it's making people feel comfortable to do that. And I think that's more than just one or two actions. I think it's more than just encouraging people. We've got to make the whole culture of the organisation more comfortable for people to be able to do that.
Thank you, Deborah. And before I go to my next question, I'm going to invite Councillor Goodrick come in, and I think it's been partly answered, Caroline, but if you'd like to come in, please.
Thank you, Chair. I just wonder why the staff are not happy highlighting ethnicity, because actually we should be celebrating that diversity across the authority, and actually we should be welcoming it. So I'd like to understand why they're not happy and why, in that way, without it, we can't celebrate that diversity and give them the opportunities to actually stand up.
I agree, and we certainly should be celebrating diversity because it's the right thing, and also because for business reasons, we need to have all the talent that we can to make North Yorkshire County Council as good as it can be. I think, and we'll have to see about the how the graduates work programme develops, but I think that's a key role, to be honest, to work on those issues and find out why the things behind, why people aren't declaring. Because as you say, you know, that's vital to help us move forward, really.
Yeah. Can I just...
Please come in.
It's not just about celebrating the diversity, but by having that diversity, actually we're bringing information and learning into the council, which should then shape what we do as a council. So I think we've got to try and make them feel valued and their experiences valued, because then we can use that in shaping our projects going forward for the community.
Absolutely.
And I think, if I may, on 4.5, I think the fact that the Assistant Chief Exec, Legal and Democratic, is part of the team gives it some weight, Caroline. And maybe, Deborah, you would bring an update to the mid-cycle briefing or a briefing note to that briefing. And then if there was concerns by the chair and group leaders, we could then highlight that concern and maybe ask for further reports to the committee or endorse what actions have been taken. Are you happy with that, Deborah?
Absolutely, yes. I'd be happy to do that.
And members, if we just have a quick canter through the appendix, and if anyone wishes to raise any questions as I go through, if you use the chat box, and if I don't see anybody, I shall just sort of canter on. But on page 16, ensure that people can maintain access to essential services. I don't see anyone there with a question. The second one is working with customers to ensure council's digital by default strategy is inclusive of a wide range of customers possible, taking into account different access requirements and the needs of those who experience digital exclusion. I think we all must be happy with that one. Don't see anyone there. The third one, improve the well-being and inclusion of lesbian, gay, bisexual and trans children and young people. Well, I've one there, Deborah, and I think it's really important that we as an authority do everything possible. And I know younger persons do extremely well with that. And I was involved with a piece of work with LGBT, which I'm proud to be associated with. And it is just confirmation, Deborah, that we as an authority are really doing everything we can do with that.
Yes, that's a colleague, colleagues in Children and Young People Service, obviously, who deal with that area of work. But we certainly usually do very well in the Stonewall Education Equality Index on our work in relation to LGBT. So I mean, I will take that back to my colleagues in CYPS and emphasise the importance that we need to put behind that.
Yeah, I personally find in a brief At the briefing prior to this meeting, both Councillors Randerson and Griffiths were fully supportive of that as well. We think it's vitally important that we as an authority act in as responsible a manner as we can. Councillor Goodrick has put something in the chat bar there, of which Caroline, do you want to ask the question, Caroline? Are you happy staying in the chat box and it be answered later or...?
It can be answered later.
Thank you, Caroline. So Ray will pick that up and make note of that. He's nodded, so he's all right. Bryn, I'd like to invite you in, please. Councillor Griffiths.
Sorry about that. I'm flipping between screens here and doing the best. On item 4 in the appendix, you're talking about improved vulnerable groups of children. Do you specifically look at the Gypsy and Travel community in this?
Yes, we do. Yes, basically, it's based on the vulnerabilities identified in the Children and Young People's Plan. Having said that, we, in terms of our new objectives that we're working up, we are. Thinking about putting in a specific objective about Gypsy Roma Traveller.
I'd welcome that and would support it. It's an issue which keeps getting swept under the carpet.
Yes.
Around here. Thank you.
Thank you, Bryn. Thank you, Deborah, for that. And move on to number 5, and that's improve access to employment opportunities for young people not in education, i.e. NEETs. Has anyone any questions on that? There's no one in the chat, but Annabelle's typing something. We can come back to it. Nothing.
Chair, is it easy for me just to quickly say?
Yes, Councillor Wilkinson, by all means, you can come in.
Thank you. I just wanted to say that all the new, we have now new young people's councils in each area, as you know, the new groups, and they are working to make sure that everybody's included and there is a broad diversity and LGBT are included. So just to give you an update on that, I'm sure they'll be feeding that back to you.
That's really encouraging, Annabelle, and it is vitally important right across the age range, is that. Can I invite Councillor Anderson, Tony?
Yes, thanks. Can you hear me, Derek?
Yes, yeah.
Please, yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry, I jumped. I was going on to volunteer strategy.
All right, I'll come back to you, don't worry.
Yeah.
Councillor Goodrick, can I invite you in?
Thank you, Chair. We seem to have, at the last meeting that we had with Justine Brooksbank, a surplus in our apprenticeship levy that we're not using. And it's about trying to make best use of that money rather than it go back to the government. And if we can encourage some of these young people who are not in education training to try and find something that they're interested in, that we can find an apprenticeship or a course that they can do, it seems to be better use of that money than it going back to the government. And I'm really keen that we look at that, and when we come onto the youth justice system, using some of it in the youth justice system as well to try and encourage them to make better use of their lives.
Councillor Goodrick, you're nearly one step in front of the chairman on this with your justice. So just hang fire a bit there. You're all right. You'll have your chance. Councillor Peacock, Yvonne. Hey there, Yvonne. Councillor Peacock has a question on agenda item 6, take opportunities where it is appropriate to do so to improve accessibility of public transport. Ray, if you can make a note of that, and we might
I'm back on, Derek.
All right, up you go.
I don't know what happened. Everything just went off. And it's just the fact that when the right deep rural areas, typical mine, there's not often public transport, and yet that seems to be a problem when they're going to, for poor 16 to go to school. And I just think that is still an equality and diversity thing, because to be equal across the county, when you live such a long way away from the colleges, it is a problem. And I'm hoping that we'd have a look at that sometime in the next year, before next next intake next September, because I just feel that if there's no public transport to the nearest college, then, you know, we have to be considering that they're not being treated equally. It's too much to answer today, but I just feel I want to put that flag up that we do need to look a bit more carefully at this.
Yeah, Yvonne, it's right that you lay a marker down and touching on Councillor Goodrick's previous conversation about an underspending monies. It's maybe something that not for our committee to decide upon, but it's maybe something that Councillor Wilkinson will have registered with her and take to young people's, etc., and identify that problem that you've raised there, Councillor Peacock. It's a very valid point as well. Deborah, is there anything you'd like to comment on that before we move on?
No, that's fine. I think that's the appropriate route, yes.
Thank you. Councillor Wilkinson is saying she will do. Thank you, Annabel. Move on to agenda item 7, take opportunities where it is proportionate to do so to improve physical accessibility around our towns. No one anything to raise on that. Number 8, foster good relations between our staff who share a protected characteristic and our staff who do not. I think we have touched on that, Deborah, you correct me if I'm wrong, covering what, both with BAME and LGBT. Would that be fair to say, Deborah?
Yes, I think that's correct.
Thank you. No members have indicated the wish to speak on that. That concludes the appendix. Deborah, I think it's an excellent report, and I think there's been some real good questions in there raised that if they can be taken back, and then we could receive an update to the report and our questions, if that was at all possible, please.
Absolutely, will do.
And Deborah, I'd like to thank you for coming along and presenting the report this morning to us, and look forward to seeing you again. And members would note the recommendation to note the report, and we have provided comments in it. Thank you, Deborah. Thank you again.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Move on. Bye-bye. Agenda item 5, corporate volunteer project. Keely, are you there?
I am, yes.
Oh, where are you? Can't see you.
I'm here.
Oh, that's all right then, as long as you're there, that's all that matters, love. Keely, it's over to you then, love.
Thank you, Chairman. You'll recall that we attended the overview and scrutiny last year on a couple of occasions to give an update on the corporate volunteer project. So this is providing a further update 1 year on our progress. You'll see from the report, Chair, that we have made some progress on some of the work that we set out to do, largely around the volunteer strategy, the expenses policy and protocol, and the ID badges and a triage tool. And particularly the protocol on the volunteer ID badges was really useful when they were setting up some volunteers to do with co-volunteering and having a consistent protocol whereby we actually knew what type of ID badges we were going to issue and the format for that. So that has proved very useful. You'll also see 3.7 with regard to COVID volunteering, that whilst many of the North Yorkshire County Council volunteers who perhaps did footpath inspections or worked in children's centres or worked for the Rotters producing waste reduction, they all ceased their volunteering during full lockdown. But we did then work with community service organisations to actually get COVID volunteers. And you can see in there that there was between 1,500 and 2,000 volunteers that were helping in the communities. And we know that that was a really big thing that brought them together for North Yorkshire and really helped. So with our future focus, item 4, you can see that we have continued pieces of work to do for the corporate volunteer project. Around efficiencies around the volunteer journey and the volunteer training. And you can see that we've also looking at developing some specific volunteer opportunities for young people, because we feel that that will help them to get more involved in local communities and also to support them to understand some of the work that the local authority does more, in view of perhaps being an employer of choice for the future to try and get more talent into the organisation. And you see as well that we have acknowledged the value of the COVID volunteers as well, and looking at raising the profile of volunteers off the back of that. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Keely. Invite Councillor Griffiths in. Bryn.
That's better. Sorry, I've got an IT issue there.
Yeah, you're there.
Thank you, Keely. Appreciate that report. Just in terms of paragraph 4.2 and your last bullet point, I'm all for developing volunteer opportunities for young people. Do we recognise the work that the young people do when they volunteer? Is there some formal sort of certification that they can have which can help them in future job opportunities or further education?
That's actually the area we feel that we need to develop a bit more. My first ever employment, I was involved in the Millennium Volunteer Scheme, which was set up by government about 20 years ago, whereby they got formal recognition through certificates that were nationally recognised. And the North Yorkshire County Council volunteers, we do have a certificate we can provide all volunteers. It's not specific to young people, but we feel that young people really benefit from volunteering, particularly things such as getting a reference from the manager that they've volunteered for, so that they can show that the work that they've done has been recognised, not just as a sense of giving something back to the community, but helping them to develop their skills and showing that they are being able to be punctual. So that's the sort of thing that we're hoping to build into the young person's volunteering framework, is that we will provide a reference for them and some sort of recognition to say that they've committed so many hours over a prolonged or even a short period of time.
Is there any, if I may, Chair, is there any then link into a national award or a national certification?
There isn't a national scheme at the moment for specifically for young people. I think there may be a scheme that where there's some sort of accreditation, but there is some costs associated with that. It's something we could certainly look into a little bit more, but there's not a national scheme for young people where it's like all organisations can sign up to it and that they give out certificates for them. And that's really the driver for why we want to do something, because we feel as a large employer, we should be offering something a little bit more for young people where it's recognised.
Thank you.
Thank you, Keely. And before I go to Councillors Jordan, Randerson and Goodrick, I would just like to endorse Councillor Griffith's concerns there, Keely, because whilst there maybe isn't a national certification, is it something that we could be a trailblazer for, a leader for, and really promote such a national certification and lead on this? So with respect, it isn't just a piece of A4 paper that we're churning out. It is something of quality and of good standing that really would recognise what these young people have done and give them the confidence to and appreciate what they've got is a valuable piece of paper. And I think that is, by word of mouth, one good way of passing among the peers and everything else, is that if you become a volunteer at county, look what I've got, it's just more than an A4. It's helped me, really helped me get a job, and it's a nationally recognised certificate.
Yes, Chair. One of the things we are looking at, and I think it links with Councillor Caroline Goodrick's point with regards schools and colleges, is we are looking at the Duke of Edinburgh Award, because we know that that has the volunteer element within it and that is nationally recognised. So whilst Duke of Edinburgh is much wider scheme than just volunteering, it does have that element. So that could be a way in which we could link into the volunteering element and get that national recognition. So we are looking at linking with schools and colleges to try and tap into that and make them aware that we do offer the volunteering opportunities that would count towards the Duke of Edinburgh, which I believe they have to do volunteering for the bronze, the silver and the gold award.
Yeah, and so if we could explore it, please, Kayleigh, be it either Duke of Edinburgh or we've become a trailblazer for something. I think, you know, I'd soon see County be a trailblazer for something, never mind tack it on a Duke of Edinburgh. Let's be out there, let's be bold and have a go. Can I invite Councillor Jordan to come in, Mike?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Good morning. Obviously, with COVID, a lot of people appeared out of nowhere to come forward and help with volunteering. What we're doing as a county council going forward, I personally am helping keeping these contacts together locally. We've had a post-COVID meeting and we've had a get together to thank all those locally involved in it. Is somebody gathering this information as to these people, because a lot of them had never volunteered before and they were prepared to do stuff which nobody had been thinking about doing before. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mike.
Thanks, Councillor Jordan. Chair, may I respond to that?
Yes, please. Yeah, please do. Look.
Yeah. It's the Stronger Communities team who are working closely with the community service organisations to record that information. And what we are very mindful is ensuring that any volunteers that are being recruited now, that we are putting them to best use, and we're not just recruiting more who then don't subsequently get used. So we are working closely with the Stronger Communities team and the community support organisations to look at need in specific areas relating to COVID. What we don't want to happen is to have a second lockdown whereby we haven't got the numbers of volunteers to support the local communities. So, but we have got some areas where there is need. So we have in the council developed an online form that is up and running now, and that where we can recruit new volunteers. And that's enabling us to get the contact details for the volunteers and all the relevant consents with GDPR so that we can contact them about future volunteering opportunities. So, albeit, for heaven's sake, if there was some other crisis or emergency next year or a second or a third COVID spike, that we've got these people on our books, as it were, to be able to contact them. And that might be for similar related crisis volunteering opportunities as well. So we are being very mindful, also a bit recognising and respecting GDPR, that we are capturing people's information to try and harness that for future volunteering opportunities.
Thank you, Kayleigh.
Thanks, Chair.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Can I invite Councillor Anderson in? Tony, please.
Yeah, thanks, Chairman. Yeah, I'd just like to talk briefly about the volunteer strategy and the expenses, because it's something I'm particularly pleased about, the fact that we did flag this up at one of our recent meetings, that we were concerned that, you know, there'd be a them and us scenario with the full-time employees and our volunteers. We felt that would be completely incorrect. So I'm delighted to see that there is this project, and it does look as though it's equality for all. So I'd just like to flag that up, Mr. Chairman, that, you know, this has been taken on board, and I'm particularly delighted about it. Could I also, whilst I'm on, Mr. Chairman, also echo your sentiments and Councillor Brin's sentiments about the certificates? I do think it's important that North Yorkshire County Council does go that step further with a specifically awarded certificate for all our young volunteers that hopefully will help them pursue a career in their chosen career during the course of time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Tony. Councillor Goodrick, do you want to ask that question? Are you happy leaving it in the chat box?
It's really to support you, Chair, because I think if we can give a credible qualification for the volunteering, I think that's important. But I think in order to perhaps facilitate that, perhaps we should speak to Julie Bunn, who is head of the virtual school, to see if we can devise something that would make that qualification of benefit and of value.
Yeah, and I think, Caroline, it's something, as I said, with the greatest of respect to everyone, it's something a bit more than an A4 piece of paper we want. If we can be a trailblazer, again, I'll repeat it, a trailblazer and national leader on something like this, then let County hang the hat on it and let other people come to us and ask us how we did it type of thing. And that's what I'd like to see. I noticed Councillor Jordan's nodding and others will be, no doubt. So I think, Keely, you've got a fairly clear steer of where we'd like to go with this, if you'd like to comment.
Thank you, Chair. I have a couple of weeks' time, got a meeting also set up with North Yorkshire Youth, who do a lot of youth volunteering schemes, and looking at how we can work with them on this to develop something that is similar to what you say with regard being quality and recognised.
Yeah. And if I may, because there's no one else in at the moment, if I may ask a question, Kayleigh, is do we have any problems with minority groups similar to we've highlighted in diversity and equality in agenda item 4? Do we have any problems there that is giving us concern or should give us concern?
Thanks, Chair. We don't actually capture the specific information at point of application with regard to the ethnicity of all the different people that volunteer. And also some of our volunteers are actually in the wider community, so like the community libraries who have their own recruitment approach. We are aware that we do have quite a diverse background of volunteers. So you may have seen that during COVID that there was some news articles with regard to the refugees who were volunteering with the community support. So we are aware that volunteering does attract people from all different sectors, and we're very, very keen to support that. With relation to the previous agenda item and the diversity and inclusion that Deb Hugill spoke about, she mentioned about the new graduate diversity and inclusion officer, and that individual is actually appointed to within our team, and I've actually had a meeting with her this morning, and I think there'll be quite a lot of synergies there with her work and diversity inclusion and bringing that across to volunteering. So it's certainly we're naturally set up well to have that and make sure it's embedded across volunteering and not just across employees. Thanks, Chair.
That's really encouraging to hear that, Kayleigh. It really is, because you know we need to treat our volunteers as we do employees as well, in the same vein, and give them as much respect as possible. And Kayleigh, if I may, over on page 38 under our principles, and it's on the third bullet point, and where it says there that enabling and encouraging a diverse range of people to volunteer. Kayleigh, I would like to have seen that as being a lead rather than, with the greatest of respect, it seems if it's been tacked onto something where it starts barriers to volunteering are removed where possible, and then somebody sort of had a light bulb moment and think, well, we better add that on the end. I would like to see, and it was agreed at leaders meeting, pre-meeting, that we would like to see this as a bullet point in its own right. So, as we're there, we're bold, and we're quite proud of making that statement of encouraging a diverse range of people to volunteer. Are you comfortable with that, Kayleigh?
Yes, we're certainly, Chair, we can feed that back to our corporate volunteer subgroup, which represents all the directorates, and share that with you to switching that round so that it's prioritised differently within the strategy.
Well, if it's a principle, Kayleigh, then I think we should be proud of our principles. If we are going to be proud, then we should be proud and bold about it. There's no other questions in the chat box, Kayleigh. So I'd like to thank you for coming along. No, wait a minute, Councillor Wilkinson. Annabelle.
Sorry, Chair. I just wanted to say that during COVID, a lot of our young people have... Oops. I had a slight problem there with my computer. You all went. A lot of the young people through the young people's councils and all the very different groups that we have already running, and the new young groups that I mentioned earlier, have been volunteering, and they have set themselves targets to continue to do this. So we've already got all these different things in place. It would just be wonderful, as you've already said, to bring them all together, so that because I think we're actually doing things that we don't even know about at the moment with this, because we're working in such an awkward, you know, virtuals rather than reality. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Annabelle. Kayleigh, I think you've got that message, didn't you?
Yeah.
And members, I think we're happy to support the recommendation, and I think we've given some food for thought for Kayleigh. And again, Kayleigh, thank you very much for coming along and answering our questions that have been presented to you this morning.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you for everyone for their feedback and comments.
And if we can move on to the second part, which is a verbal-only update, and ask Liz Mead. Liz, are you there?
I am, yes, thank you. Hello,
if
Chair.
If you'd like to come in, love, please.
There we go, thank you.
And it's over to you.
Thank you very much. We've been working in Stronger Communities programme with the 23 community support organisations across the county to coordinate the massive volunteer effort that we've heard of from Kayleigh as well, actually, so that no one felt alone or without food during the pandemic, that kind of immediate response. The programme and the team identified pre-existing, at the end of March, we identified the pre-existing community organisations across the county, and we partnered with them to develop the community support organisations that we shorthand as CSOs. They were able to offer support in their local communities through trusted volunteers. This was a mix of the pre-existing volunteers that they had as organisations and new volunteers coming forward who were wanting to help at this time. And what we found is that no two CSOs were identical, that they very much reflected the local community that they worked in. So, for example, in kind of the Nidderdale Valley, they very much, the community support organisation operated very much through a network of 13 local village networks. Within Scarborough, there was a grouping of VCS organisations that took on support. And then, for example, in Tadcaster, it was the local community car scheme, who also offers other services, that took on the role of CSO. They very much reflected who those people in those communities would look towards. They, in turn, were working closely with other partner organisations in those areas at a grassroots level. They may be residence organisations, faith groups and parish councils, very much sharing out the tasks between them. Many of the residence groups set up kind of volunteers for each street, or the organisations, the smaller ones, took on the responsibility of a particular task, say it's shopping or prescription collection. Because of the nature of the situation we found ourselves in, it was crucial that the volunteers had as shorter distance as possible to travel and that support was offered at a local level. Through this structure as a programme, we were able to offer support and information to these groups to overcome and help them with the situation they found themselves in. For example, in the early days, it became very apparent that access to money for people to purchase their shopping became very difficult. People unexpectedly found themselves at home and they found that they had a shortage of cash. We were able to overcome this, one, by supporting with the development of information on the website about safe ways that people could share kind of pass over money to people that were supporting them, messages around please don't share your credit, your cards with people, etc. And as a county, we were able to facilitate the setting up of a petty cash system that worked across the community support organisations, so relatives or the people themselves could do back transfers to pay for the shopping to alleviate the need for having money available. And there was also the NILAF COVID-19 grant that enabled volunteers to have the voucher to purchase people's shopping. We found that across county, the top requests for volunteering were help with shopping. This occurred both on a long-term weekly basis and one-off requests. In total, between April and the end of August, 3,560 shops were delivered across the county. Again, prescriptions were something that was crucial for people, and many volunteers were delivering prescriptions. In total, I think over 2,500 prescriptions have been delivered during the time. This led to many local relationships being established with GP surgeries and pharmacies, and pharmacies were supporting volunteers by preparing prescriptions in geographical kind of order rather than alphabetical order. So it actually helped that somebody could come along, pick those prescriptions up and deliver them at a certain time. So it really showed how in communities we were all able to work together to do our bit to help people get what they needed. Food parcels, again, was a kind of, and a number of the CSOs were directly linked to food banks. And we found that from April to August, the demand for hot meals increased as people weren't able to get out to luncheon clubs or weren't able to access kind of family who may have helped them support with kind of getting hot meals. And a number of our Stronger Communities response grants were used for the setup of hot meal delivery schemes. Telephone befriending has also increased throughout the time, really because of that importance of keeping people socially connected to what they're doing. We very much wanted the volunteers to do this safely, so we were able to produce some guidance to help them to do this. We did this during this time. And also we found that these phone calls continued, but there was also things occurred like somebody had dropped off shopping to a residential block and understood that the residents were keen to see people. So I think she bought her Shetland pony to walk around the outside of the block just so people could have that interaction. And although those things seemed quite small in the middle of lockdown, they were crucial to keep people connected with that bigger picture, and they could share that story and had some think to tell and share with other people they were talking to. That was also really important around the volunteering. That has continued. Jigsaws, books and activity packs were also important, and group set up ways of quarantining these so that volunteers could deliver them safely out to people to help them keep busy and active. North Yorkshire Sport received some funding from ourselves and other partners to develop activity packs, and they gave out bags for people to kind of keep them occupied and busy at home across ages of older people, families and younger people as well. And also pets, not to be forgotten, people's pets kind of walking. I think we had in some instances horses being fed and pet food being dropped off. There's a range of things that the communities were able to get involved with. And across this, I think what we found was that people being helped peaked, as we would assume, between May and June, with around 3,700 to 4,600 people being supported each week through the community support organisations. This did reduce in July and August as people started going out, but we're still maintaining a level of over 2,000 people being helped each week through one of the ways I've just suggested before. This is being supported by active volunteers of around 1,500 each week in the community. And we have registered with the CSOs 3,000 volunteers who between them have completed over 50,000 hours of volunteering. This still continues, and we are very much continuing to encourage people to volunteer, support their family and friends. But also, a lot of the CSOs, as Keely mentioned, are now making contact with those volunteers to thank them, pass on kind of gratitude, celebrate what they've done, but also ask them if they'd like to continue volunteering for the organisation as they move into business as usual. Many groups that are reopening are also looking and discovering that they need to reassess their volunteers. Some people have chosen not to come back to them as yet. So some of the volunteers for the CSOs are moving into supporting these organisations. As a team, we've been able to offer guidance throughout this, and we've established now a website page on the North Yorkshire Internet to help groups and link them into where there's guidance on setting up and starting up. So we're very much continuing with response and recovery across the county in partnership with the community organisations and the community residents themselves, dependent on the local situation. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. Can I invite Councillor Goodrick? Caroline? Caroline, you'll have to unmute.
can't hear me.
You can. I can now, love, yeah.
Right, okay. A thought went through my head about the individualism of each area and how it should shape going forward what we do with our constituency committees, Chair, so that we recognise individual areas that have different needs and different wants.
Liz, can you comment on that? Or would you like to comment on it?
Yeah, I think we have found in, yes, I think in terms of CSOs and how we're working, we've very much found that kind of looking at that individual, what's happening in the communities has really benefited how we've been able to develop and grow what's been there and work in partnership with.
Thank you. Councillor Jordan, Mike, can I invite you in?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. In my area, we sorted out the group, and we used a buddy system. I buddied up with five families and did their shopping and prescription runs for the whole of it, well, for about 12 weeks in total. But one of the things that surprised me, and I was really pleased, and but that there doesn't seem to be much talked about on this, is the pharmacies, how the pharmacies themselves were prepared to go out of their way. They hardly get a mention, but I went to three different pharmacies during this period, and the staff were very helpful. They were quite prepared to give out people's prescriptions, even though they didn't know me from Adam, as long as I gave the Christian names. But they made it so easy for all of us to do this. And we were straight in and straight out with these prescriptions. And I think all the pharmacies need recognising for that, because I think they did a cracking job. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mike. And I think anybody that had you as a buddy was really lucky. I think, Liz, I think you did mention the pharmacies, didn't you, earlier on in your report?
I did, yes. I did mention how there's a number of pharmacies that, as you say, have been really accommodating of individual people collecting, but also that kind of preparing prescriptions in a geographical kind of order, which really helped the volunteers.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, Mike, thank you. Can I invite Councillor Arnold in? Val?
Hello. Hi.
Hello.
I'll get this machine to work in a minute.
Language value on live.
Just a comment, Chairman, please. Just to say that I am glad of all the support. Excellent report, by the way, that we're giving all the volunteers. And the volunteers have been absolutely excellent in all areas throughout the pandemic. And just to say, what would we do without these marvellous people? Thanks.
Thank you, Val. And in support of Councillor Goodrick and area committees, etc., I think your report, Liz, and comments could be fed into area committees as well. And then if there are any anomalies, any gaps there, anything that needs filling in, that would work in very well there, Liz, I'm feeling sure. Liz, what I am really pleased to hear about was the Nidderdale, where 13 villages were working together. And you think, you know, here we are, North Yorkshire County Council, the size we are, and yet we can prove we can pull 13 villages together to work in such, you know, extreme circumstances as lockdown. I think it's a credit to county that we could work so well with these villages and with our CSOs there. So, you know, please pass on mine and the committee thanks to all CSOs, I mean. But I think it's just so heartening and reassuring that as a county, the size we are, we can work without any problem on the size.
Thank you.
I don't see any more questions in the chat box, Liz, so it only leaves me to thank you for coming on this morning and giving that verbal update, and you'll keep us informed in future of any further developments, I feel sure.
Yeah, I will. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Liz, and thank you again for coming along. Members, it moves us on to agenda item 6, annual review of County Council locality budgets, and I'd like to invite Neil Irvine in. Neil, are you there?
Yes, good morning, Chairman.
Good morning to you, Neil. It's over to you.
Thank you. This is the annual report on locality budgets. It covers the last financial year. So that's the fifth year of operation of locality budgets. This year, or in the year in question, the fifth year, we merged the administration of locality budgets and the environmental locality budgets. So you can't do a direct comparison between the previous year's report, as that didn't include environmental locality budgets. So the aim of locality budgets is to enable county councillors to respond to local needs in their division, things that they think are important that will promote the social, economic, environmental well-being of the communities they represent. And individual county councillors are very much the heart of locality budgets. It's their decision about how they identify, prioritise projects or activities to make the most effective use of the resource for their area. In terms of administration and decision making, we try and do three things. We try and make sure it's timely and responsive. So members submit their recommendations at any time online. They're reviewed by officers for eligibility and the decision by the executive member. And then the organisation managing the grant gets an offer letter which they need to sign. And normally at the moment we turn that round in about a week. The second one is it's about diligent but proportionate. There's a variation in the size of individual recommendations, but lots of them are well under £1,000. And clearly we need to be diligent, but we also need to make sure we're not spending a huge amount of money on administering a relatively small amount. And then finally about transparency. So we do publish all the awards on the website and we have this annual report. Last year there were 559 projects supported, a wide range of projects. There's details in the appendices about every approved recommendation and some analysis about the type of organisation and project. In terms of the current year, we made an earlier start because of COVID, and county councillors were particularly encouraged to think about the impact of COVID on their communities, the impact of climate change, as well as promoting stronger communities. Because of the exceptional nature of the pandemic, the chairman of the county council has given a blanket call-in exception, which means that decisions can be made even faster. The last date for receipt of recommendations this financial year is the 31st of January. And so far we've had 221 recommendations, which is equivalent to about 36% of the budget, which is similar to where we would be in other years. Happy to answer any questions, Chair.
Thank you, Neil. And just for members' benefit, because you've all glanced through and see who spent what, no doubt, I am somewhat surprised because my total bid was 9,700 there or thereabouts, and yet I'm recognised of only spending 8.86 or 8.3. Where it's going to lie, I know not. But I didn't want members to think that the chairman had been lazy and not apportioning his money. You need to laugh, Councillor Jordan. Apportioning his money responsibly. So that's something I'll discuss with the exec member later. Has anyone any questions, comments? Yes, Mike. Come in, Mike. Councillor Jordan.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, just to say it's interesting to go through the list because it would appear that Sherburne now, where I live, didn't need anything at all, really. Power.
Well, with a buddy like you, you know, that what more could they want? There's no other question.
Thank you for that, Chair. Sorry, thank you for that. I've got £624.52 left this year.
Spend it wisely, sir. Spend it wisely. Councillor Goodrick, come in, please.
Thanks, Chairman. Just to say that I have the largest geographic area in for a division in the county, and I try and make my budget stretch around all those villages. So generally where they've already had something, they're not asked to bid again unless it's something really specific, because I just feel that we are trying to get our communities fairly treated around and about. And then it's always disappointing to know where another councillor makes a comment on another councillor's budget spending. But I'll leave it at that, Chairman. Thank you.
Point taken. It was directed at me. No other comments, questions or otherwise. Neil, you've heard it. Everyone satisfied. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair.
And look forward to submitting many more requests to you and Councillor Chance. Neil, Neil, I would like to place on record, and I feel sure the committee will support me, in the way that Louise is turning these round, and her team, admittedly, but I would like to place on record the committee's thanks for that, because they are being turned round, you know, I'm not being facetious, one hell of a speed. Please pass on our thanks and appreciation to Louise and the rest of the team, please.
I will do. Thank you.
Thank you, Neil. Members, we'll move on to agenda item 7, which is the Youth Justice presentation. And we have Steve Walker on board. Are we, Steve?
Yes, good morning.
Where are you?
I think I'm here. I can see you.
There you are.
Thank you.
You're on. Right, over to you, Steve. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Before I launch into this, can I just make a blatant trawl against the localities budget item? We have a very good little project that provides employment training support to young people carrying out environmental tasks in local parishes. If there's any work that needs doing, then we're always available for that on the coast. I've popped a note over to Ray, which you can circulate to members if anyone wants to see it.
If you would, Steve, if you would make sure that all members, not just this committee, but all members of county are aware of that offer, please.
And I'll do that.
Ray will have picked that up, no doubt.
I'll do that. Thank you.
So it's over to you then, Steve. Thank you.
Thank you. So this was an interesting brief because we normally provide presentations to elected members explaining how wonderful everything is and how we're meeting all our targets and well done us. But we were asked on this occasion to focus on the more challenging areas, the places that were stuck or that needed new thinking, where elected members wanted to perhaps get a grasp of the kind of challenges facing a service. That's a really interesting and useful analysis, and I'm going to deliver it, but you're going to have to tolerate an amount of boasting before we get to that, because we've just had the result back from our national inspection. HMIP, the probation inspectorate, is the equivalent of Ofsted for our service. So they rock up every 5 years. It's a massive event, very reputational. And we have the final report now, and it's very good. We've got a good with some outstanding features. I've pasted in a couple of key extracts from the report, which I won't read to you, but you can see from those sections of text that the inspectorate has made very positive findings about the quality of work in this area. And that spreads across the whole partnership. It's not just about the quality of the frontline staff. It's also about the partnerships, the leadership, the strategic governance. So we're very pleased about that. The official report will be published this week. There are press statements being prepared now. And that's it, really. So I wouldn't have survived if I hadn't told you about that first. The team would have hurt me. So,
Steve, don't worry. The chairman can cope with boasting. Choose who's boasting, so don't worry about that.
Thank you. So moving on to the meat of it, which would be your slide 96. I was asked to brief you on 5 challenging areas. So this is the first one. This is really about the transition that children face on their 18th birthday, which really is a cliff edge. It leads to a loss of support across so many services. And we know that 18-year-old young people are not actually competent. We now confidently know from psychology and research that young people don't fully mature until their mid-20s. I mean, any of us looking back to the decisions we made when we were 18 or 19, would we want to be bound by those clothes, those haircuts, those decisions? And we're often talking about young people who faced immense stress and deprivation. So they're not ordinary children. I mean, when my stupid son goes and gets himself into trouble, I bail him out. I lend him money. I drive across the country and fix it for him. But the young people that we support don't have supportive families. They don't have families who have the resources to bail them out of trouble. If they run up a huge bill on their mobile phone or something like that, they're stuck. So that's a real challenge for us, because everything that we are seeing suggests that we should continue to treat 18 and 19 year old young people as effectively the older end of children, and we should continue to support them. But culturally and legally, they just become 18 and they're adults. We don't have a strong plan for that, to be honest, because essentially it's out of our hands. It's about a social debate about responsibility and citizenship and enfranchisement. The age of 18 for attaining adulthood is not going to change. It's certainly not going to change. But what we are seeing now is in a couple of national themes, in particular psychology and psychiatry, the health service. Services are now starting to talk about 0 to 25s as a spectrum of need rather than a hard break-off. That's very important, especially for CAMHS services, because there are times where children can fall into a no man's land between services. If they're late 16 or 17 years old, CAMHS services will often not want to become involved with them because they're nearly adult and nothing will be achieved until a relationship is made. But adult services won't touch them until they're over 18 and a referral has been made and accepted. So you can end up with an unintended gap there of 6 or 12 months where a child in crisis has no support. The other factor that we are doing to mitigate that is about how we manage our own transitions. We have, as a service, adopted a position that young people move to the adult probation service when they are ready. And we routinely keep young people for 6 or 12 months or more on occasion. By agreement with the probation service, each case is negotiated and planned. And that's especially important for the care leavers who we look after. So we try and wrap a package around those care leavers so that they go in a very smooth and supported transition when they're ready to do that. But we're lucky in that our local national probation service are very positive and flexible about that. The local manager has worked with us for a long time to improve this. And that kind of smooth handover doesn't work as well across many other services. So it is a real challenge for us, and I can't tell you how we're going to fix it. I can tell you things that we are doing. We are trying to work towards a different model of practice for ourselves, where we're focused more on the child's development and insight and maturation rather than on abstract thresholds or ages or birthdays and so forth. And we're trying to work more holistically around the factors that get young people into trouble or out of trouble. Impulsivity, for example, poor decision-making skills, being vulnerable to peer influence. Those are all things that can make a teenager get into trouble in a dozen different ways. They can come home with a tattoo one day. They can get in a fight. They can have a row at work and get sacked. So we're trying to go for those maturing and developing things to give these young people the widest possible toolkit so that they can succeed in adult life, and really focusing on helping them to catch up. Many of them, about 15% of the children we work with, are currently or previously in the care of a local authority. And more than half of them have special educational needs or other very severe deprivations. So we're really now seeing it almost as a finishing school for adulthood rather than an exercise in lecturing them about offending behaviour.
Steve?
Yes?
You want to take questions as from page to page, rather, or do you want them?
I think that might be
so
useful.
Has anyone any questions on transition to adulthood for Steve? If not, then Steve, can we go on to disproportionate criminalisation of looked after children?
My absolute pleasure. I can think of nothing less to talk about. This is a key issue for us across the criminal justice system and nationally. We know from research that there's a very high prevalence of children from the care system ending up in prison. Most recently now, that is something close to half of all children in prison, in the youth prison system, have previously been in the care of a local authority. And nearly half of them are also black or minority ethnic. So what we're seeing is, as the custodial system shrinks for very, very good reasons, and it's a huge success, a small group of young people are not quite being taken with it. And we need to attack this systemically right from the beginning. We need to stop those children coming into the criminal justice system in the first place, because they've come into our care. So we know that they have been through terrible deprivations, neglect and abuse. If those things hadn't happened to them, they would not be coming into our care. There would be other solutions for those children. So we know that they don't have the same capacity to manage stress, that they can't contain their emotions as well. They're impulsive and short-sighted. They have angry, self-defensive, lashing out behaviours if they feel that people are threatening them. We know the needs that these young people have. And because of that behaviour, they are much more likely to get into trouble. They're much more likely to get into trouble at school or with the police because they have outbursts. They get angry, they get upset, they lose control. If we just let nature take its course, we know that those children are going to be criminalised at more than five times the rate of young people who are living with their own families. That then leads to a massive escalator effect, because they go up a rung and up a rung and up a rung in the criminal justice system faster than we can do anything. Within 12 to 18 months, an angry, disaffected child in our care system will be in custody. And there is nothing we can do in that timescale, because the healing and support that they need to be able to move on to a better life is going to take many, many more years. We had a young woman go to custody last week. She's 14 years old, an immensely angry and upset young woman. We needed 5 years to work with her. We couldn't change it in that time frame. So this is an exercise, really, in changing the criminal justice system. We know that what we are doing is right, not just my own service, obviously, but right across children's services. We know we're good at supporting children who've experienced abuse and neglect. What we have to do is we have to get the police and the magistrates and everyone, the CPS and so forth, to slow down this process and give us time to work with these children. We've been working on that in North Yorkshire for quite a long time. We've had protocols in place with the police and CPS for more than 15 years. We are regarded as a national leader, in fact, because we're much further ahead than most local authorities. We've done some great work in our own children's home. No Wrong Door, you'll be aware, has taken a very strict line now that they do not call the police on their own children. Good parents don't call the police on their own children. So that's been a really big improvement. But we do have an issue that a significant number of looked after children in North Yorkshire are not actually in our care. They're in private children's homes. placed there by local authorities all over the country. And the quality of that is quite variable. There are some private homes who more or less match us in terms of their commitment to the welfare of their children and how far they will go, how they use restorative justice and positive diversion. There are others who show very little tolerance to angry behaviour and tend to call the police very quickly. We do not have any governance, licensing or registration powers over private children's homes. They can buy a small house, turn it into a children's home, and we just have to deal with that. We are, through Youth Justice particularly, trying to establish positive and influential relationships with those private homes to improve the quality of their practice. We're offering them training and support, particularly around restorative justice. But it very much depends on whether they want to work with us and also the kind of young people who are placed with them and how long for. Some elected members will be aware that the private care system is it's a very fast churning system and young people move around the country very rapidly. So we will quite commonly hear that a very angry 15-year-old from Liverpool has just arrived in a private children's home in Selby. There'll be a few weeks of uproar and calls to the police and appearances in court, and then that child will disappear. She'll be in a private children's home in Wales or a private children's home in Norwich, because the private care system moves children around as a solution to challenging behaviour, which obviously, in our opinion, is tantamount to abuse, and we won't place any of our children into that system. But what we are doing to tackle this, we are focusing especially on our care leavers. It's that 18-year-old cliff edge again, that we know our care leavers have the same developmental difficulties and life experiences they had the day before their 18th birthday. So we're trying to provide better support for them through the criminal justice system. The care leaving service is going to do some really good work visiting young people in custody and helping them to plan for a better life ahead. We're going to do a training program right across the criminal justice system, the magistrates, the Crown Prosecution lawyers, the defence lawyers, and give them all a half-day briefing on simple child development issues. Things like trauma and abuse, the impact of ACEs, as some people who have adverse childhood experiences, to try and get people to understand that the angry tearaway that's shouting at them in a courtroom isn't being consciously disrespectful and defiant in the same way that an ordinary child might be. They have to be understood in their own capacity and needs. We have a major issue about engaging the private care providers. We have very good informal relationships with some of them. It often depends on who the registered manager is for each children's home. Some of them are positive and collaborative, others tend to prefer to run a bit of a closed shop. And we are trying to engage the major national provider, who is Cambion Care. That's a stock exchange listed massive company with hundreds of children's homes across England and Wales. And they have a number, I think 4 or 5 children's homes in our area. So we're trying to make a corporate relationship with them, which will sustain beyond individual manager relationships. The other element is the engagement of City of York, because we are developing a national protocol to try and pull together all of the work that we're doing to divert and support these young people. But we need to resolve whether City of York are going to come in with us on this. And at the moment, they're 1 foot in and 1 foot out, depending on what day you ask them. So that's another key action at the moment which we're driving, is to get them to commit one way or the other. It's clearly a big advantage because the police and the courts and the probation service, everyone else is a single service across York and North Yorkshire. So if we can agree a standard model that we're all going to work to, that will be a very big advantage for children. But what we can't do is let York continue to hold us back. So it's going to reach a point soon where they're going to come or we'll go without them. And that will finally lead to a detailed written protocol and governance plan, which will include clear reports and action plans for how we continue to improve.
Thanks, Steve. I'll go to Councillor Jordan first. He has a question, Mike. I'm just going to have to get my lead as well. But Mike, if you'd like to come in.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Yeah, that report made very sobering reading, and you've just re-emphasised it. Which is, it's a bit of a tragedy in many respects. Just a simple question, but I know it's a very hard answer, and I'd like to know your views on this. What effect do you think social media has had on this going forward?
Not a great deal, to be honest. I mean, children in the care system have always been very prone to offending. I mean, for as long as I've worked in this line of work, the children in care homes have always been pulled into crime, and they've always been targeted for sexual exploitation. They've always had difficult experiences at school. It comes as a parcel for those children. Social media has been problematic for us in a whole range of ways. Definitely. But I don't think it's particularly causing criminalisation of looked after children.
Okay, thank you.
Shall I move on to the next item? If we go
please
to
Steve,
page...
I think we may have temporarily lost the chair, so if you could just continue to the next item, we'll see if the chair returns.
Excellent. I was probably overwhelmed by the sheer power and rhetoric of my presentation. It's understandable.
Thank you.
Okay, well, we'll move to your page 98 now, which is about educational attainment. And again, this is a critically important one to us, because we know school is the core of everything that children learn about life, not just the academic certificates and badges that they get, but school is where they learn to cooperate with each other. It's where they learn to obey rules and cooperate for common good, to play in teams, to deal with victory and disappointment, to deal with bullies. School is the place where a lot of pastoral care and health care is focused on young people. So we need our children to be in school. We need them to be happy and successful in school. And that historically has been a significant challenge for us. It is improving. It is improving gradually and through a lot of hard work. We are now getting, I think, more than half of our children are in regular education now. But it is a real challenge. And a significant part of that is because their behavior tends to be seen as chosen behavior, as naughtiness. And you can get into a vicious circle very quickly, but if their special needs are not identified and not seen as something that needs to be planned for and supported, then they just become seen more and more as naughty and problematic. And then they very quickly take that label on themselves and become the class clown or the school bully, or they just don't go to school anymore. One key factor in that is the extent to which special educational needs are being missed. We did a piece of work about 3 years ago, where we were able to employ a specialist SEND teacher for a year. And she systematically assessed all of the young people who we were currently working with. And what we found approximately was that about half of our children had special educational needs which had been recognised in school, and every single one of the other children had special educational needs which hadn't been recognised in school. This included quite significant issues like dyslexia, speech and language conditions, ADHD, Asperger spectrum disorders, hearing disorders, impaired sight. There were many children who were struggling to keep up with their peers because they had actual disabilities and impairments which made it hard for them to do that. And of course, we all know that if children slip behind the class, if they start to feel stupid and left behind, if they start to be the problem, they will take that label into themselves and think that they are stupid. Their parents will think that they're stupid. You know, it becomes a self-perpetuating story that the child could do better if they made an effort. They just don't want to. So we need to do more around making sure that schools and services have a clear grasp of the child's cognitive ability as early as possible in school, ideally in the primary schools, ideally before they ever meet our service. Because if a child gets from primary school to secondary school in a positive transition and they're happy, they almost certainly will not then get into trouble with the police. They have a happy and fulfilling life. So that's really, really important for us. The big challenge really is about gaining support from the schools. And there's a wide range of difference across the schools. Some of them are really, really good. There are schools who will give a chance to any child. There are schools who will take children from travelling communities, children who've just come out of custody, children with homemade tattoos, children with Tourette syndrome who'll shout obscenities in the middle of lessons. There are some super schools, and there are others who are less accessible. And we have to accept that is in a context of their own regulatory and performance framework, but Ofsted does not currently praise or endorse schools who go out of their way to support young people with challenging behaviour. It will often reflect poorly on a school in Ofsted terms to have very challenging or high need young people from the care system, for example, or young unaccompanied migrants. So we need, I think, to do more to support and encourage schools to be inclusive, to find space for these young people. And there is some good work going on for that. The North Yorkshire Ladder of Intervention, I think some elected members will be aware of. It's an education and early help system which sets out a process by which schools can call in support from the early help service and try and hold children in the school rather than expelling them, which just puts them on the street to be someone else's problem. Stuart Carlton is driving that to a massive extent. It's a very big project for him. As the chair of our Youth Justice Board, he's really quite determined to abolish the necessity for our service. And the best way to do that is to keep young people in positive education. So we have some health workers in the team, we have some speech and language workers, and we have some very good education workers who are all helping us to do that. But that really is the big push to get as many of our children back into school as possible, or better still, to stop them dropping out. Okay?
Yeah.
I'll pause there.
Thanks, Dave. Can I invite, and first of all, apologies, battery went flat and it went before I could even get to a plug to turn it back on, but apologies for missing out momentarily. Can I invite Councillor Goodrick in? Caroline?
Thank you, Chair. It's really important. I hear what you say about schools not identifying these children, and I do worry about the academisation of schools and whether they will keep difficult children in the academy or whether they will push them away. And also, one of the things that worries me about young children is they also don't want to be labelled by whatever problem they have. So if they're dyslexic or they can't hear, or because then that brings in a level of bullying that they find difficult to cope with. So there's an awful lot of balancing to do with all of this. It does worry me. And I do hope that at some time we can find some way to support our youngsters that up to the age of 25, whether it's just like a safe house, a virtual safe house where they can go, they can sound off and get a non-judgmental response or help to how they might sort things out. There's so many things that affect why they end up in the youth justice system, and worries me greatly.
Thank you. I would agree.
And Councillor Griffiths, Bryn, did you want to come in? Yeah, come in then, please, Bryn.
Thanks, Chair. Sorry, I'm juggling between screens again. Just a couple of points on the education side. One point in particular, and Caroline glanced on it. Are you finding any difference between the way county schools respond to these people and academy schools?
Oh, I would not dare answer that question. We don't have the data. It's not something we've gone and looked at. But as a personal opinion, I suspect there probably is a difference. And I think I probably agree with Councillor Goodrick's concerns that the academies and private schools are probably more likely to be less supportive and inclusive. Whether we carried out a piece of research to evidence that and what we would do with it if we did, I don't know.
I'm not trying to make a political point at all. I'm just concerned that I know that from my own experience as a school governor, both primary and secondary, it is very difficult to engage with some of these children. And
it is.
One of our schools is particularly trying to be accommodating. The other perhaps is less so.
Yeah.
No, I think it's a fair point you've made, Bryn. And I think Steve's answered it sort of, not disrespectfully, but within his capabilities of answering it in a non-political way. Steve, could I ask where it says what needs to happen, explore options to incentivize and support inclusive schools? Can you expand on that a bit? Is it a case of just offering more money up and not monitoring results, etc., is it?
I'm so pleased you asked about that. This, I think, is something that we potentially could discuss with elected members and as part of the culture and values of the County Council. I don't think we can just give them money. It's not as simple as that. And writing a system of what money you'd give for why would be impossible. But I think what we can do is we can make it positive and prestigious to support these children. We can make it, I hesitate to say shameful, but we can make it a little embarrassing not to. We can say what we want from them. I mean, to give you an example, if we knew that in this area there was a range of welcomeness for children with disabilities, that would never be acceptable. It just wouldn't be acceptable. So what I think we need to do is try and get to that point where it just becomes normal that schools will find room for these children.
Yeah.
And I think one of the ways I would like to approach that, and this is strictly a personal opinion rather than a recommendation on behalf of a service, is to use the places we have on governor's boards in all of those schools more effectively and proactively. It's my understanding that the county council holds at least one governor's seat on every school in the county. And that in many cases, those are carried out by volunteer members of staff who do it as public service. And that's lovely. But we're not giving them any information or briefing to take into those meetings. And I wonder what would happen if we could give them briefings.
Yeah.
So that they could go to their governor's meeting and say, why does our school have this level of performance compared to other schools? why are we doing this well or badly? Because we know that there are schools that do this tremendously well, not just young people who are in trouble with the police, but also young people in the care system, unaccompanied young asylum seekers, children from traveller communities, all of that group of difficult, awkward, more demanding young people. I'd really like to find a way to use our seats in the governor's meetings to press schools to be more accountable.
Steve, I don't know whether it could be done or not, but it's maybe where a briefing is given to the county rep,
yeah,
who acts as a governor. And it's maybe something that we need to explore, you know, whether we explore it, our young people's services explore, whoever explores it. But I think it's maybe something that needs exploring, and, you know, to get the best of our membership and seats at tables. I think it's a way forward.
And I think so.
Rael have made a note about that, I feel sure.
I mean, another key one to focus on that is exclusion rates. Because, interestingly, the rates of fixed-term and permanent exclusion and the rates of young people being educated off the premises are also very correlated indications of how accessible and inclusive schools are. So I wonder if we put together a brief or a league table or a report that said this is where we are with schools in North Yorkshire, those governors could go into schools and say, well, our school doesn't seem to be as inclusive and tolerant as the one up the road.
Yeah.
Why are we excluding far more children than they are?
Yeah.
I mean, it's an enormously provocative and personal opinion, and I'll probably get shot for it later, but...
No, Steve, you won't get shot for it because as chairman, I'm promoting it. So don't worry about that. You won't get shot about it. It's me that's put my neck on the line. But Ray's going to take it to young people's ONS and group spoke. So we'll leave it at that, Steve. You know, I think everyone knows where we're coming from with it. And let's see what's the best we can get out of it. There's no other questions in the chat box. So if we can move on then.
Okay.
Please, Dave. Thank you.
So last two items. The first one is around county lines. I'm going to assume that most elected members are familiar with this concept, but essentially it's urban drug gangs have realised that they can run a line of hard drugs into a rural or coastal community and dominate the market very easily without having the kind of difficulties they have in urban environments. And what that's done really is it's very dramatically changed the landscape for our outlying communities. Initially, Scarborough was targeted more than anywhere, but now we're seeing Harrogate targeted to a very substantial extent, probably because there's more disposable cash in the local economy, we suspect. We have gangs at present coming in from Bradford, Birmingham, Liverpool, Manchester. At any given time, there are between 10 and 15 of these lines operating. And a line is essentially a phone number that you call to arrange to meet a dealer and hand over the cash for the drugs. The police analysis of this at national level estimates that each line is earning between £1,000 and £3,000 a day from the community that it's targeting. So you can speculate that a minimum of £10,000 a day and potentially £45,000 a day is being taken out of North Yorkshire's economy by these groups. And that is frankly the tip of the iceberg, because the cash that they accrue from the crime is a fraction of the damage and cost caused by the crime. If, for example, I kick your front door in and I steal your microwave and your mobile phone and, I don't know, something else, your PlayStation from under your TV, I will be lucky to get £50 or £100 for all of that from some dodgy bloke around the back of a pub. It will cost you over £1,000 to replace it, and potentially another £1,000 to replace your door if I've really messed it up. So the numbers we're dealing with are quite extraordinary. And that really explains the persistence and determination of these groups, because they are extremely persistent and determined. They are very, very violent. They use large knives, machetes, zombie knives. Firearms occasionally are now being seen. They know exactly the value of what they control, and they have no intention of letting anyone take it from them. This is a very new scenario for us, because we have had very little in terms of hard drug use in the county historically. Small pockets of habitual heroin users, lots of casual old hippies smoking cannabis and the like, but not an inner city systematic business like drug business. What tends to happen is that the county lines will come into Ripon or Harrogate or wherever, and they will displace the previous arrangements and suppliers for drugs there and take over the market and basically capture it, so that they are then hoovering up all the income from that area. They notoriously use children as couriers, most commonly children from their home urban areas. So we get kids from Manchester or Birmingham, they put them on a train with a pack of heroin and a big knife, and they tell them to go to an address in Selby and hand it over to somebody and collect some money and bring the money back. We know those children are very frequently being forced to do that, either under threat of violence or because they've run up a debt and it's the only way that they can earn it back. We know that on occasion they will recruit children in their target areas as well. So some of our own North Yorkshire children have ended up being used as local runners or distributors or lookouts for these gangs. On a couple of occasions, some of our children have actually become operatives within the gangs. One of the boys that we worked with relatively recently had become a sort of local franchise and was turning over, I think, about £1,000 a day in his own account. On a sublet basis. So it's an enormous threat to our economy and to the welfare of our communities, because these people just bring in a different way of doing business. They will take over a vulnerable person's house and use it as a drug dealing base, for example. Literally hold them hostage or buy their cooperation with a supply of drugs. As soon as the police find them and shut it down, they'll just move on to another one. As soon as the police catch a courier, they'll just discard them and get another one. It's a very resilient business model, because even at the top of the gang, if you can take out the senior leaders, others will be promoted up.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's a bit of a... That's a bit of a council of despair, isn't it?
And Steve, can I ask then, where you've said that more strategic disruption and deterrence by urban police, are the police up for this, Steve? Have they been part of this document as a consultee, or how far is it on their agenda? Is it at the top of the agenda? Are they saying that they haven't got time and effort to do it, or what? Are they really keen to be involved?
I can't really answer that question, Councillor. I don't talk to the urban forces at the level where I could get that knowledge. What we hear back from our colleagues in North Yorkshire Police is that there are times when they get very good cooperation from urban forces, Greater Manchester or Merseyside or wherever. Sometimes there'll be a joint operation, they'll do great work, they'll bring a gang down or at least cause it severe damage for a period of time, and good work definitely does happen. But other times, again strictly as a personal opinion, you do have to wonder if the police in Birmingham or Leeds or wherever, just think, well, if a gang aren't shooting each other on our streets,
yeah, move them on.
Yeah, and they're not causing anywhere near that level of damage over in Shropshire or wherever they are. Is that necessarily a priority for their resources? And I can't judge that. I mean, I feel morally I want to see the Home Area Forces really jumping on these gangs, because I see these gangs as coming into North Yorkshire and causing terrible harm to our communities and children. And I want them stopped at source. It doesn't seem right that we just have to withstand it and cope with it instead of stopping it.
Is it something then, Steve, that we as a committee could write to the PCFC or whatever the correct title is for with respect to Julie Mulligan, PCC anyway, is it something that the committee could write to her and seeking her support from?
I don't think that would do any harm. I believe the Police and Crime Commissioner's office share these concerns. We have these conversations with them fairly regularly. I know that operational police officers share these concerns. And I need to emphasise, we do get lots of positive cooperation from out of area forces.
But we could ask the question through the Police Crime and Fire, PCFC, whether she thinks the support we get from urban police forces is as good as we can get, or could it be better. That's something we feel sure, and I'll put it to the committee to see what the thoughts are on that. But I think that's a positive way forward. I'd just go to committee members on that, if there's a quick thumbs up or something or other. If members are happy that we do approach the Julie Mulligan and ask that question, if just have a quick thumbs up or something. Caroline, Bryn, yeah, you're okay with it. They're all coming in now on the chat list. Yeah, so we'll do that, Steve. Ray will be listening in. We can speak later and get a letter together and sign that and send it off to Julie Mulligan and see what her thoughts are on it.
I've made a note of that, Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Ray. So if we can...
My apologies.
Custodial, please, Steve.
Yes, certainly.
Thanks.
Hopefully we have a better story for you, because we know we're winning on this one. We are reducing the number of children going into custody all the time. But as I mentioned at the beginning, the drawback is that as you continue to reduce the numbers going into a system, what you end up with is always a smaller and smaller number of children with higher and higher needs. We call this thickening the gravy in the business. So you get headlines about how the secure estate for children has reduced by 2/3 in the last 10 years. And it has. It's been an immense success. That means, you know, far more children are being safely managed in the community. But the children who are in there, still in there, tend to have very, very high needs. And it's our most vulnerable children who are most at risk of that. It's our looked after children, our children with special needs, our children who have migrated to this country. And we need to keep driving on that. I mean, I do not think we will be happy until children don't go to custody, except in the case of a very grave offence like rape or murder or something of that nature. What we can do at the moment is we can influence to an extent where our children go to custody, because there are a range of placements available. There are local authority secure children's homes, which provide a very, very good standard of care. They are essentially local authority children's homes with a great big wall around them. We try whenever we can to get our children placed in those establishments, because they are the safest and best. They have the best education and healthcare. You know, those are the places where children will come out a better and more thoughtful and positive child. There are secure training centres which are run by private sector contractors but do have a fairly good standard of staffing and provision on site. We will try and use those if we can. And then finally, there are young offender institutions, which of course our local one is Wetherby. The governor and staff at Wetherby are really nice people, and in no way do I want to denigrate anything that they do, but the quality of care for our children there is not good. They have very low levels of staffing, so much so that if they have any incidents or difficulties during the day, the only thing we can do is just lock all the children in their cells for the day. Education is constantly closed down for security reasons. Access to healthcare is problematic. Family visits, professional visits are very, very difficult to organise because the establishment is a big, cheap institution. There are two or three officers on each wing, and there isn't space for an officer to sit with a child and talk to them for a period of time. They have to be patrolling and supervising, especially because the much reduced number of institutions now have a much higher level of need young people. So in Wetherby, for example, which is now the catchment YOI for the whole north of England, they're dealing with massive gang issues where children who are sentenced in from the Leeds area are potentially going to try and kill children who are sentenced in from the Manchester area, for example. So they're having to manage on a basis where security concerns take priority over welfare concerns. It isn't barbaric. It's not, I mean, I don't want to make out that it's a dystopian and terrible thing, but it is not going to make these children any better. It's not going to move them forward positively. So having reduced the numbers we can divert away, what we're now doing is trying to reduce as far as possible the number of children who go into Wetherby. That isn't our decision. That decision is made by the prison service, in effect, but they are required to consult us and take account of our advice, and we absolutely pound them with advice and pressure to the extent that we place 70-something percent of our children in the children's homes or the STCs and 32% of our children in YOIs, which is exactly the reverse of the national average. So we are diverting twice as many of our children from that environment, but not all of them.
Steve, so, if I can come in there on Wetherby before I go to Councillor Anderson, because I took some committee members to Wetherby, and as a father of two sons, I have never been so upset and disturbed as to see how young people are treated. And I thought, people rattling tins against prison bars at windows was the thing you saw on television, not in actual life where you see young kids doing it. We came away from there physically moved, I can assure you of that. And what disturbed me more so, other than lack of education and everything else and opportunities, was the fact that Wetherby is a 24-hour reception, youth offenders, as you well know, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong. And we were told that people sentenced in different parts of the country, maybe mid-morning or whatever, weren't maybe going into Wetherby until 2, 3 a.m., simply because the van delivering these people had to hit other youth offenders that weren't 24-hour reception. Yes. Now, if that's still the case, Steve, and I'm really strong about that, if that's still the case, we as a committee, I feel sure, and I'll be doing a vote round, we want to write to the minister, drawing this inhumane action to his attention, because in a modern world like we are, people, for whatever reason, should not be treated like this. It's morally wrong that a young person is carted around the country, and they are carted around the country to various places, and then dropped off at Wetherby at gone midnight. And we were told that, and that's factual. And I'm going to invite Councillor Anderson in now, and I feel sure he'll endorse what I've said. Councillor Anderson, Tony.
Tony? Ray, can you unmute Tony?
Sorry.
I attempted to do that, Chairman.
Yeah. Thank you, Tony. Off you go.
Right. Like yourself, Derek, I've got to say I was appalled when we went round the Young Offenders Institution. Now, in my view, it's not a Young Offenders Institution. It's a prison. Yes. It's nothing short of a prison. Yeah. It reminded me of Porridge watching the television programme, Ronnie Barker, when we were going around it. And as you say, people, you know, the youngsters rattling tins on the bars. We're in the 21st century, for crying out loud. This kind of thing shouldn't be allowed to happen. You know, these are youngsters. Yes, they've done wrong, but they need help and assistance. They need that education. There isn't the resources at that institution to give them the education that they so much require. I think the point was made by the warden that when we went round it was that they would love to be able to give that education to the youngsters to set them on the right road. And he actually said that any sentence less than a year wasn't worthwhile. They couldn't pull them round in that short period of time. The sentence, if they're going to be sentenced to an institution, prison, then they should be given the amount of time to pull those kids around. And that just isn't happening. I'm just, like yourself, it's lived with me. The fact that, you know, they were dealing in shampoo or, you know, the money in there was washing soap, etc. Just unbelievable. And locked up for so many hours a day. Just not right. Thank you, Chair.
I think, Steve, you've got a fair feeling of what it was like, and that admittedly that was only one visit we had. You've had more visits, but I would ask you to respond in the chat box or thumbs up, whatever. But if you'd minded to support a letter going to the minister explaining my concerns, and I'll discuss the letter with Ray. But it is to flag up the inhuman way that people are carted around the country and then deposited at these YOIs. So if members are happy with that, then that's what's coming on the chat line. So that is an action then, Steve, that we will be doing from the committee.
Okay.
Because, you know, it in the modern day practice, isn't this?
Yes. Well, I think, I mean... Firstly, I just want to thank you and Councillor Ransom for your comments, because for our staff, it can be extremely difficult to visit these children, and it can feel as if there's nothing you can do, that they're stuck in that system. It makes an enormous difference when elected members and senior managers visit for themselves and see this and become active, because there's nothing fundamentally wrong with the people at Weatherby or with the organisation. They just need about five times as many staff and proper education facilities and healthcare, so the kids can have exercise and sport and positive things. It's only like that because it's being run on a shoestring as a very austere institution.
I think Steve, you've got the measure of where the committee's coming from. And as chairman of the committee, I was pleased to take members into Weatherby. I was pleased to take them into the ladies' prison at York and Kirk Levington. So as members got a grasp and an insight into what is available in those prisons, and members, they can speak for themselves, but I feel sure those who did attend found it interesting, rewarding, informative, call it what you want, and really an eye-opener. But the one that does stick in my mind, as Councillor Anderson says, and I can see that it gets to you, is you come away from Weatherby, and especially as a father, you come away from Weatherby and you see kids treated like that, it is just inhumane. I don't care what they've done. Nobody deserves to be treated like that, but
I better not go off on one because I shall end up in trouble, no doubt. So,
One positive thing before we leave that, by coincidence, the Youth Justice Management Board has just recently carried out a national audit exercise, submitting a report to the Youth Justice Board in London, and it has identified these very similar issues and has identified very similar actions. I'll send a copy of that report over, and you, what you might want to do is to coordinate perhaps with Stuart Carlton or with others in terms of how these concerns are taken up at national level.
Sorry, Steve.
In a positive piece of news, literally last week, as I was preparing materials for another report, I learned that the prisoner escort system is being significantly improved in a new round of contracts. The vans are now going to have toilet facilities and comfort breaks, and they're going to stop the process of driving children all around the countryside for financial efficiency. So it does look as if there is some improvement coming at a national level, but it's always so slow and so stubborn, and any amount of pressure continues to be worthwhile. Thank you.
Yeah. I hear what you're saying about there's going to be a change of mode of transport and, you know, tea and coffee machines, very facetious, I know that was, but, you know, toilet blocks and this, that and the other. But it will not stop me, and unless committee members vote against me, it will not stop me writing to express concerns of how people are treated. It won't, honestly.
And please do. I think it's wonderful. I think it's what corporate parenting actually means.
You know, it's what we're all responsible for, Steve.
Many of those children
are responsible for other people's children, but some people can't be responsible for their own children for whatever reason. And we've got to accept that, rightly or wrongly. But I bet it shouldn't, because I'll get told off in a minute. Right.
I usually do.
I think that's been the last hour's been very well spent in going through that. And I would congratulate you and the team on a pleasing inspection rate.
Thank you.
Bearing in mind our comments and concerns, but not directed at yourself, obviously. But, you know, thanks for coming along. And, you know, I hope we see you again and things remain on a positive uplift. And we'll keep you informed of any progress we can make through letter writing.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for your time today. It's very much appreciated.
Thank you very much, Steve. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Right, bye-bye. Right, members, you've got in front of you item 8, draft work programme. Ray, my friend, are you there?
I am, Chair.
Would you like to say a few words?
I don't really need to say a great deal. I think, Chair, the information's there before you. I mean, the relevant page has started 102.
Yeah.
As you can see, this is the first meeting we've had that's been broadcast since the outbreak of the pandemic. You have some mid-cycle briefings coming up, and then the next committee on the 7th of December. Obviously, my colleague Melanie Carr will pick up an awful lot of the things, well, all the things that have been discussed today, Chairman. You've agreed some extra actions, some things that you want to see happen. Some of those reflect upon your work programme, so we'll tweak those. But unless members have any particular comments they want to raise or any particular ideas about work going forward, that concludes my item, Chairman.
Thank you, Ray. And there's no members haven't put anything into the chat box. All it leaves me to do then is thank everybody for their attendance, involvement this morning, because there have been very important issues we have discussed at our committee, and I think everyone will gauge, especially from the chairman down to other members, we have very strong feelings about things of which we do follow up, and we like to see improvements. So to that end, I'll thank you all once again, bid you good day, and close the meeting.
Thank you, Chair.